Hey everyone, and welcome to Integrity Church Online.
We are so glad you're here. Let's get started.
Thank you so much for joining us. I'm Connie.
And I'm Paul.
And we want to welcome you here to Integrity Church. Here, we want to let you know that you are loved by everyone here at Integrity Church and loved by God. So that's something that we are very passionate about telling you. We know that we had this crazy storm. Everyone's still kind of recovering. So we are praying and we're thinking about your family. But if you still are in recovery mode and you have any individual prayer requests, or if you just need a practical hand, if you need some assistance, please feel free to reach out. And there are so many people in the church that are willing to be there for you and help you in any way that you need.
Absolutely. What we're here to do today, as with every other day, is to inspire you to passionately follow Jesus. We're going to listen to a sermon today from Pastor Tony. He gave it last Sunday evening. Mm-hmm. It's called The New Life, and it has to do with the two ordinances that the church has done for many, many years. And those two ordinances are baptism and the Lord's Supper. And so why don't you take a moment and make sure that you've got crackers or bread or maybe some juice around, because Pastor Frank is actually going to lead us through some communion this time. So I have here some bread, but unfortunately I forgot the juice.
The grape juice?
I forgot the grape juice.
And I have that right here.
Oh, so check that out.
Perfect.
That's awesome.
So now that we're all prepared, why don't we all come together and we'll join for a time of worship.
That great. so worthy. I need rescue, my sin is heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing, now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open, cause when you call my name, shout it, I ran out of that breath, yeah, out of the darkness, into your glorious day, you called my name, and I ran out of that breath, out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
Christ and entered into newness of life, right? Now we're going to go into a new song. Well, sort of new. This is the first time we get to play it as a congregation, but you might have heard it, you know, over the live stream. But this song is called Grace in the Gardens, and it talks about the way that Christ completely flips our trajectory. We who were once dead in our sins and destined to eternal death are now, through Christ, alive and made new. And what joy we can have knowing that truth. So if you experience that joy, let's rejoice together in this new song. Maybe you haven't come to that place where you've experienced the joy of knowing Christ. Let this song challenge you. Let the truths of it stick in your minds. Because every word is true. God changes graves where dead people go into gardens where new life is found. So let's sing this together.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise and treasures that fade were never enough. And you came along.
Lord of our lives. We love you, Father. We want to praise you for your goodness. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Sing this to God's heart. Your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness.
Yeah. We'll sing of your goodness. God, you are so good. No matter what is going on around us, you are always so good. And I pray that we would take the advice given in this song, that we would sing of the goodness of God. Even if we can't hold a melody, that we would still sing our heart's desire to love you, to trust you, to know you. And that as we do, we would just receive unbelievable refreshing, because you are a God who knows how to refresh his children. I thank you for this time that we could be together right now, just lifting up your name, just giving you all the glory in this place. The heavens and the earth declare the glory of the Lord, and so do we tonight. So Lord, I just do pray that as we continue to worship you, Lord, as we hear your word, that you would speak to our hearts and just make the way so that we would understand what you're saying to us tonight, so we can respond and draw closer to you and to know you better. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray all of these things. Amen.
As we spoke about before, we'll be continuing in the evenings with our 7:30 services outside. So all of you can look forward to that. Also, after these services at night for the month of August, we'll be having an outdoor movie and ice cream. So we hope that you come and join us for that.
Thank you, Connie. So in addition to having the services at Sunday night live, we're going to be broadcasting that live. And that's actually what's occurring right now. So we have folks from our congregation that are watching live right now. And in addition, we're going to be taking the sermon that we're seeing today, the teaching portion, and rebroadcasting on that on Sunday mornings. So next Sunday morning, you'll get a recap of this, and then you can come back next Sunday night and get a new message. Cool? Yeah. That's absolutely. Also wanted to just put a quick plug in. The other night, we spoke a little bit about a new service called Integrity Connect Now. And we actually started it this weekend. We started it slow. We're going to be ramping it up. What it is a way for us, a way for you, a way for new people that haven't been a part of Integrity to connect with members of our church, whether that's for questions that need answers or for prayer. And the way it works is you'd actually see an icon on the bottom of our webpage, or you'd follow a link that we'll be showing in some of our social media this week as well. And what it actually brings you in real-time chat, like you have done on webpage, or real-time text message, or near real-time email, or real-time Facebook Messenger, lets you interact with some folks that have signed up and that are going to be set up and willing and ready to answer your questions, and sometimes even more importantly, to pray with you in real time. So we're excited about that. We encourage you to use that service to even if it's a simple question, rather than giving a call to somebody, just jump online and do a chat, okay?
We also have an upcoming baptism service. So if any of you are interested in getting baptized, please talk to Pastor Tony or talk to one of the pastors after the service tonight so that we can give you more information on that.
Before I share with you, I just want to take a couple of moments. You know, we're here together in the presence of the Lord. How many believe that God's presence is here? And I think that as God's people come together in the presence of God, this is a great time to go to the Lord in a time of prayer for our country, for our leadership, for the church in America. We've got so much that's going on around us, and I just... Before we go any further, I just want to take a moment of pause and just come before the Lord together in a word of prayer. Can we do that? Let's just pray together. Father, we recognize that you are God over all. Lord, we recognize that our land is broken. We recognize that sin has been manifest all throughout our land. God, we ask you to forgive us. Father, we pray for America today. Lord, this nation that once stood with conviction and righteousness, but has so drifted from her foundations. God, I pray that you would visit our land once again. That you would heal our land, God. Lord, that you would bring healing over the division and the brokenness in our land. We pray, Father, for the Church of Jesus Christ in America. That, God, we'd not get sidetracked with all of the politics and the talking points of the day. That we'd recognize the biggest problem is not in America, but over America. Recognizing that there is a spiritual battle in this nation. And God, I pray that as the Church of Jesus Christ, that we would uphold righteousness. Lord, that we would love all people like you love all people. That we would model the character of Jesus Christ in our nation. And that, God, that you would bring healing to our land. Your word reminds us that if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, then you will hear from heaven and heal our land. And so, Lord, we ask that you would bring healing to our land today. Start, Lord, with us as individuals, as the church. In Christ's name we pray. Lord, we pray for our leaders. Father, for those that we voted in and those we didn't vote in. Those we like and those we don't like. Lord, we pray that you would move upon the leadership of America. Nationally, locally, all throughout our land. Lord, you'd raise up men and women of conviction. Lord, that you'd raise a voice in this nation that would point our leaders to you. That they not rely on their own strength and their own wisdom, but that, God, that they would look to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. We need to remember to pray for our country. Amen. Well, in the midst of all of the distracting chatter, I mean, there's a lot of chatter out there. Right? All the conversations that are out there that tend to cause all kinds of anxiety and fear. I find it refreshing to be able to come together tonight, to pull away from it all, and just be in the presence of the Lord. To have our perspective adjusted. To be reminded that we are citizens of heaven first. That God is in control. And that God loves you. And he loves me. I love the fact that we'll have an opportunity shortly to partake of communion together. I was really feeling in my heart as I was telling Pastor Tom this, I was struggling. I'm like, I couldn't pinpoint what the Lord would have me to bring. I know I don't want to just preach a message. I want to preach the right message, the right timing message that the Lord would have us focus on. And I just didn't want us to focus on all that's going on around us. I fear that with all that's going on, it can serve as a tremendous distraction for the church. It can cause people to forget that in the midst of it all, that God is sovereign over it all. That God's in control. That God loves you. That he's aware of the concerns of your heart. That God has not changed his plan. He's still working on plan A. Tonight, Pastor Frank's going to lead us through communion. Something that we've not shared together live for a little over 5 months. So I was looking forward to focusing on what Christ has done for us. What a great song to end on. The goodness of God. I mean, I can say God's been good to me. The goodness of God. There are two ordinances that the church has observed over the centuries. Baptism and the Lord's Supper. No matter what the church was going through, no matter the amount of intensity of persecution or blessing that the church was experiencing, in the midst of it all, the highs, the lows, and there was historically a whole bunch of both. The church always gathered together and shared in these two ordinances together, baptism and the Lord's Supper. A time to pause. A time to reflect. A time to remember what Christ has done for us. I can see the wisdom of God in calling us to come together on a regular basis and to share in the Lord's Supper together, a time to remember what Christ has done. Each of these ordinances, baptism and the Lord's Supper, they communicate the very essence of what the gospel is. In symbol form and in practice, we are reminded of the goodness of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ. Baptism, as you know, it follows salvation. It is not a means of salvation, but baptism is a public declaration of an inward reality. And I pray that if you've not been baptized, that you'd see one of us, because we'll be doing one here in the parking lot very soon. But if it follows our baptism, it's what we're called to do. Paul, in writing to the Church of Rome in Romans chapter 6, gives us a picture of baptism. He says, "Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life." Paul paints a beautiful picture for us of the symbolism of baptism. That while in the waters of baptism, prior to going down for the plunge, we are symbolically standing there in our old nature, condemned. And as we go down in the waters of baptism, we are dying to our sin, dying with Christ. And as we're coming out, we're being raised to newness of life. Such beautiful symbolism in the baptism experience. If you've not been baptized, again, I really encourage you to make sure you do that. We follow the Lord's command, as we see in Matthew, in the Great Commission. Jesus says to go into all of the world and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. It's a public declaration of an inward reality. You say, "Pastor, we know that. I know you know that, but you know, I think sometimes we need to be reminded. I think sometimes we can get so consumed with everything else that we can fail to take those moments of pause and reflect on the goodness of God. And so we have baptism and we have the Lord's Supper as a reminder that our biggest problem was solved in the person of Jesus Christ, taking upon himself our sins. The condemnation that was launched against us, Christ bore on his body, going to the cross for you and for me. And Christ took our punishment for our sins." Paul, without using the word baptism, beautifully explains what baptism fully symbolizes in just one verse. And you oftentimes hear me use this verse. I'm going to share it. We're going to unpack it a little bit further this evening. He does it so beautifully in Galatians chapter 2 in verse 20. Paul says this. He says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life that I live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. No other passage of Scripture, in my estimation, better articulates the Christian journey. I have been crucified with Christ. You see, somebody had to die. Each and every one of us are born in sin. You see, the bad news is that every person is born separated from God. Everyone born of Adam is born with this sin nature that separates us from God. Romans chapter 6 and verse 23 says, for the wages of sin is death. And so we've been born in sin, and that nature of sin manifests itself in our actions. How many don't need to look too far back to see how you've manifested your sinful nature? The scripture says the wages of sin is death, and Paul says, I have been crucified with Christ. Somebody had to die for my sin. And you see, Christ died for me. The bad news is that we've been born sinners, separated from God. But the good news is that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. God stepped into our biggest problem and became the solution in the person of Jesus Christ. I have been crucified with Christ. Paul says in Romans 5, for while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one might scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone would even dare to die. But God shows his love for us in this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. In our worst possible state, while we were the enemies of God, God stepped in and solved our biggest problem. Man's biggest problem is not the problems that we hear on the news today. Man's biggest problem is man is born separated from God, and the solution has not changed. And we who have been recipients of the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, we then need to bear that truth to the world around us. He says, it is no longer I who live. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live. It speaks of a new identity. What I was prior to Christ doesn't exist anymore. Because who I was died on the cross with Christ, and now I'm a new creation. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation, the scripture says. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And so you're not what you were. If you've come to Christ, don't let your past haunt you. You're a new creation. He says it's no longer I who live. Romans 6, verse 8 says, now if we have died with Christ, we believe we also live with him. It is no longer I who live, but he says, but Christ who lives in me. Christ who lives in me. Think about that for a moment. Your life, my life, ought to reflect who lives inside of me. We're not what we were. Our old identity has been killed. It's been crucified. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. We looked at this passage last week where Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, we have this treasure in jars of clay or in earthen vessels. to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. Don't forget who you are in Jesus Christ. Don't let the cares of this life, the worries of this world, distract you from who God says you are. You're a son of God. You're a daughter of the King. You're a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. You're a rare heir because God has stepped into your life and changed you. Christ, who lives me, he says, and now the life that I live in the flesh. I'm still alive. You could check your pulse if you're, check the neighbor next to you, make sure everybody's got a pulse tonight. You're physically alive. And so we are mandated, we are commissioned to live out the life of Christ in this world. You and I are commissioned to be Jesus to the world around us. The life that I now live in the faith, Paul says in church of to the church of Philippi, for to me to live is Christ. To die is gain. My living ought to reflect the one that I love so much because he first loved me. I don't know about you, but it challenges my heart. It reminds me that I represent something bigger than myself, someone greater than me. And the waters of baptism reminds us that we were raised into newness of life. That newness of life is to reflect the character of Christ in the world around us. And then look how Paul closes up that verse. He says, and the life that I live by faith in the Son of God. In other words, every one of my days is viewed through the lens of my faith in Jesus Christ. It's what sends me out. It's what commissions me. I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me. How much? And gave himself for me. This is the Christian experience. This is the Christian reality. This is the essence of what it means to be a Christian. The exchange of our sinful nature for the righteous nature of Jesus Christ. When you became a Christian, you didn't just adopt some new belief system. There was a miracle that took place, an exchange that took place. Jesus exchanged your sinful nature with his righteousness. And so when God sees you, he doesn't see what you were. He doesn't see your failures or your shortcomings. He sees the righteousness of his very Son. And he says, I love you. You're mine. That's what Christ has done for us on the cross. Apart from Christ, we were destined to eternity separated from God, unable to save ourselves, unable to do anything about it, but God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Regardless of what's going on in the world around us, we must view what we see through the lens of what Christ has done for us and respond accordingly, responding as people of faith. Be careful to not get distracted by all of the media that you fail to remember that God is in control. He's in control. He loves you. He loves you, not because of what you do or how cute you are. But he loves you because he's created you and he's redeemed you and he's called you his own. And I think that in the midst of all of the loud voices around us, these precious truths that the church has gathered together and celebrated over the centuries, we need to make sure we return and regularly visit them, to take those moments of pause where we recognize that God, in his grace and his mercy, stepped into this life that was so undeserving and went to the cross for us. We do that, we communicate that, certainly by baptism, but then we also do that in the celebration of the Lord's Supper. And I'm going to ask Pastor Frank if he'd come. And has everybody been served one of those little cups and nasty wafers?
You know, this is an awesome setting. Now, I love outdoor services. It just brings me back to some very fond memories. Years ago in the early 80s, I was working with a church in the Bronx in the Randall Avenue projects. You know, when you go over to Throgneck Bridge and you see the sign Randall Avenue, to the left of that is housing projects. Looks pretty innocent from the highway. Rough neighborhood, man. But we did a lot of outdoor stuff. I mean, Saturday mornings we'd go. We had a big panel van that the side peeled down, and we did puppet shows for kids. We did outdoor services like this right in the community. And I remember one night in particular, everything went wrong. I mean, we didn't have this elaborate setup like Pastor Tom has done tonight and under his expertise. I mean, this is amazing. We didn't have this. We just had kind of like a sound system and a microphone, and, you know, the music was, we just had so much trouble with putting this service together. We had a guest speaker that night. Her name was Amy Cortese, and she was a powerful woman of God. She stood to the mic, and she said, I want to tell you three things tonight. And it was like, I'm telling you, it's like the world stopped, because we had hecklers in the crowd. I mean, it was a wild scene, you know. It wasn't church like we know it. And people came to the windows. I remember looking up in the buildings and seeing people. They came right to the window. They wanted to hear what she had to say. I'm going to tell you three things tonight, she said. Number one, God loves you. She explained what that meant. And number two was, we're all sinners. She talked about that. And then number three, she said, but Christ. I'm telling you, it was like the world stopped at that moment. It was, you could hear a pin drop in the neighborhood. It was like she just really just nailed it that night, and God was using her in a mighty way. And that's really what it comes down to. It comes down to the realization that, yeah, God loves us. His love is unmeasurable. We don't even really understand the degree that God loves us. We don't understand unconditional love in a lot of ways, but that's the way God loves us. And we're all sinners. We've all sinned. We've all fallen short. We've missed the mark. But Jesus, but Christ. You know, I think about what Jesus has done for you and I. Jesus was the one that he spoke this world into existence. He was the creator of the world. I mean, the creator of the universe. I mean, he had so much power and authority. And yet he left that position and that crown in heaven to put on a crown of thorns for you and I. He had to make that decision to follow God's will and God's plan, just like we do. But he knew he had to come, because it was the only way that you and I could be set free from our sin. If we're going to ever resolve anything in this world, we've got to resolve the sin problem. That's really the basis of all the issues that we're facing. And so it's interesting, because as we come to a saving knowledge of Christ, and then we realize that we can take that message to our world and our community and the people that we're around, the people that we meet in the marketplace, and the people that we are on the job with and people we come in contact with, spreading the love of Christ. That's what's going to make the difference in this world. And what a privilege and an honor to be able to carry that message. And so when Jesus was with his disciples the last time, they was at the Last Supper. This was the last moment that he was going to be with them physically on earth as far as the way things were. And he gave us communion, the Lord's Supper, as a remembrance. He said, do this until I come again. And so the church gathers together, and it's called communion, and it's got that sense of community that brings us together. And we realize, we look back and remember what Christ has done for us, that we've been set free, that we can know forgiveness in our lives. And we remember that. And he said, I won't partake together again until we get to heaven. What a communion service that's going to be, man. That's going to be wild. It's going to be nice. But we do this to remember Christ. And so the Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 that Jesus, when he took the bread, he broke it. And he said, this is my body broken for you. Now, the disciples had no clue what Jesus was really talking about. They didn't know what he was going to have to go through, the brokenness that he was going to have to experience. But he did it for you and I. He was broken so we could be made whole. Physical suffering was a tremendous experience at the cross. But even more than that, he had to experience what it was to have the Father turn away from him, because he took all our sin upon himself. I can't even handle my own. Can't imagine everyone's. He took it upon himself. So his body was broken so that we could be made whole. So we're going to partake together tonight, and we're going to thank God. But here's what I want you to do. I just want you to take a minute here, just a few moments, because the Bible tells us that we're really to examine ourselves before we partake. And there's a caution there that we shouldn't partake in an unworthy manner. In other words, if there's unconfessed sin in our life, that we should make that right. And we can do that just by asking God to forgive us. But we have the privilege to examine ourselves, to look inside and say, God, is there anything in my life that, you know, shouldn't be there, or maybe I've experienced this week? And we need to continue to go back to that place where the Lord cleanses us. You know, we live in a dirty world, and sometimes we get the dirt of the world on us, you know? And so we need the Lord to cleanse us. And so I'm going to ask you to take a moment just to, and you could maybe say, well, there's nothing in my life, but ask God, God, is there anything in my life? Maybe you've just been living in fear of what's going on around you. My mask says faith over fear. And it's interesting. I was in the store the other day, and one lady said to me, oh, I love your mask. And I said, yeah, do you believe it? She says, oh, yeah. You know, so we had a little conversation about faith and fear, you know. Maybe it's just that you've been consumed by what's going on around you. What's tomorrow look like? What's going to happen? You know, are my kids going to go back to school? Am I going to be allowed to go back to college? What's happening with my job? Am I going to get my job back? Am I going to be, so many things. And the Lord wants us to know that he sees all of those. He works those out in our lives. So let's take a moment and just examine ourselves tonight. Thank you, Lord. So Jesus took the bread and he broke it and gave thanks and said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's partake together tonight. Then he took the cup and he said, the cup really represented his shed blood, forgiveness of sins, a cleansing that we experience in our lives because of the cross. He blessed it and again said, "Do this in remembrance of me." There's forgiveness in Christ. There's wholeness. There's freedom and liberation. So as we partake together tonight, just realize that it just wasn't Jesus shedding his blood, but was what it represented to God the Father. That you and I are covered because of Christ. Let's partake together tonight. Thank you, Jesus. We'll send a basket around to collect that from you. And Pastor Tony's going to come back and give us some instruction. I just want to mention that if you did have offering tonight, and with no pressure at all, certainly want this service to be a gift, but there is a box over there if you'd like to put anything in. Thank you.
Lord, thanks for this time. Pray, Lord, just to seal these things in our hearts, that you continue to remind us of your word and how that applies to our lives. May we reflect who loves us so much. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Hi everyone, welcome back. We want to let you know about some of the upcoming events that are happening in the church. I know many of you have been showing up at them, which has been awesome. But as many of you know, we are having our outdoor Sunday evening services at 7:30 p.m. So we'd love if you'd show up to those. We have the worship time as well as the sermon, the service part of it, as well as afterwards, we're doing an outdoor movie and ice cream. So we are all looking forward to that. So hopefully you'll show up and join us in that awesome time in the parking lot in the evening. Also, during that time, we have something that I thought was really clever. It's different wristband colors. So right now we're respecting everyone's personal preferences regarding social distancing and really just respecting the decisions that our leadership team has made, which has been so awesome for us.
Absolutely.
So we have red, yellow, and green bracelets, and you can see when you come what each one means, so you can be comfortable and come out to all the services with us. So we hope to see you there wearing your wristband. Also, something that we've had for a long time online now has been our Connect card as well as prayer requests. So prayer requests, as always, if you're having any individual needs for prayer, please fill that out online so that someone can pray over you, pray with you, be your prayer warrior, and just be there when you need someone. Similarly, we have something called the Connect card. So if you're looking to connect in any way, whether it's getting involved in the church, whether it's your first or second time, please fill that out. We'd love to get to know you more. And just utilize that for whatever you need. In any way that you want to connect, we'd love to connect with you in that way.
Absolutely. And there's actually a couple other ways that you can connect. We've actually started a new service called Connect Now. But there's also a more traditional way through our social media, through Facebook and Instagram. We usually do about 2 posts a day, so be sure to like those. Be sure to check them out, follow us. Don't forget to share them, too. It's a great way to share the word and share Jesus. A couple other things, one of which is baptism. If you've never been baptized before or would like to get baptized, now's the time. Call the church office, email the church office, or tap a pastor on the shoulder, and they'd be happy to talk to you and talk to you about next steps. So that's a wonderful opportunity, and again, one of the ordinances that we just talked about. So everyone, I just want to thank you for joining us today. Thank you for spending the time, and we are so excited that you joined us and looking forward to seeing you again.
Thanks, guys. We love you.
Bye.